At Ward 86, a bustling outpatient HIV clinic at San Francisco General Hospital, Nurse Dion Jones drops everything when this pager goes off. It means that someone in the city just tested HIV positive.
So I'm going to make him an appointment.
Jones is following a protocol called RAPID. It's designed to get new HIV positive individuals into treatment immediately.
Just got diagnosed today. Last negative was June.
Jones scrambles to make plans for the new patient, who is seen just hours later. It's part of an ambitious plan in San Francisco to completely end new HIV infections.
Each year, an estimated 50,000 people are infected with HIV in the United States. And although the disease has moved off the front pages because treatment has made infection a more manageable and chronic condition, an estimated 13,700 people still die of AIDS in the U.S. each year. Globally, 1.5 million people are killed. It's the sixth leading cause of death.
In San Francisco, there are relatively few new HIV infections, 302 in 2014, the latest year statistics are available, and it overwhelmingly afflicts gay men. The number of new HIV infections have been falling for 8 years. Today, public health officials, doctors, and activists are increasing their effort to bring that number all the way down to zero.
We are talking about ending the HIV epidemic.
Dr. Diane Havlier is the chief of the HIV/AIDS division at San Francisco General Hospital and a founder of the city's Getting to Zero Consortium.
HIV is one of the worst epidemics of its time. It's taken a huge toll on our city, a huge toll all around the world. We know how to prevent this disease. We know how to treat this disease. So why would we not want to prevent every single infection and prevent every single death?
In San Francisco, which has spent $400 million fighting HIV over the last decade, this plan calls for controversial new drugs as well as established prevention strategies. But it starts with immediate treatment for new HIV infections.
It did, okay.
One of Dr. Havlier's patients, Jose, who's openly gay but asked us to conceal his identity because his family doesn't know about his health issue, went through the RAPID protocol when he was diagnosed with HIV almost a year ago.
And say hi. Let's check out your tongue.
Within 24 hours of being diagnosed, Jose was here at Ward 86, and days later, receiving HIV medication.
I was on medication on the third day, and undetectable within less than 30 days.
Undetectable, meaning his HIV viral load had been reduced by medication to the point where it couldn't be detected. And the faster a new patient is undetectable, the faster he reduces his chance of transmitting the virus to others. In San Francisco, about two-thirds of HIV-positive individuals are virally suppressed, like Jose, more than double the national average. But that requires an enormous effort.
They might end up in the hospital. That's where we're going to meet them again.
We followed social worker Sandra Torres on the bus as she checked up on a few patients who needed extra help keeping up with their appointments. She and other social workers are continually tracking people down.
We'll go knock on the door.
In the gritty Tenderloin district, we went to a single-room occupancy hotel where an HIV-positive patient was staying. He's an intravenous drug user and not taking medication.
Hi, honey. How you doing?
Torres dropped off an appointment reminder, and I asked her about the patient afterward.
Seems like an enormous effort for one person.
That's what it's going to take, though. That is absolutely what it's going to take.
But in San Francisco, getting to zero is also banking on the expanded use of a new tool, a drug that protects individuals from becoming infected with HIV. It's called Truvada.
If you take the pill once a day and you take it consistently, you will reduce your risk of HIV infection by at least 90% and perhaps as high as 99%.
Scott Weiner is an elected city supervisor and a member of the Getting to Zero Consortium.
It just makes sense for people to consider this additional prevention tool. It made sense for me, and I'm glad that I'm on it.
Weiner, who represents the largely gay Castro district and who is gay himself, went public about his own use of the drug regimen last fall and makes taking the once-a-day pill part of his routine each morning.
My decision to disclose is really to raise awareness so more people know about it, look into it, and to try to increase access and provide momentum for better access, and to try to reduce stigma. So whatever stereotypes people have, maybe we can help break those stereotypes.
Including the stereotype raised by some critics that taking a pill that prevents HIV infection would lead to more promiscuous behavior.
We're talking about a drug that in some circles
has a stigma of opening the door to a freewheeling sex society, and yeah. HIV is no longer a threat, and we don't have to worry about unprotected sex. Do you get any of that backlash?
There are some people who have that view, and it's really the same argument as when people would argue if you give women access to the birth control pill, you're going to just encourage them to be promiscuous. Or if you vaccinate young girls against HPV, you're going to turn them into, I think one person said you'll turn them into nymphomaniacs. Or if you give sex ed to high school students or middle school students, you're going to encourage them to be promiscuous. These are completely specious arguments. This is about giving people every tool available to protect their sexual health.
The Food and Drug Administration approved the drug Truvada for HIV prevention 3 years ago. And last year, the Centers for Disease Control issued guidelines recommending the drug for anyone with a substantial risk of HIV infection. In San Francisco, researchers believe that wider adoption of Truvada could dramatically reduce new HIV infections. In a study published in September, San Francisco's largest private health insurer, Kaiser Permanente, found that not one of its 657 clients taking Truvada had become infected with HIV during an observation period of more than 2 years. Another study published this month in the Journal of the American Medical Association showed similar results. Out of 437 individuals taking Truvada for a year, only two contracted HIV after not properly taking the drug. But so far, only a few thousand San Franciscans have taken Truvada in the last year. So why isn't the use of the drug more widespread? There are some side effects, as well as speculation that doctors may be hesitant to prescribe a preventative drug to healthy patients. And then there's the price. Although covered by most insurance, Truvada is listed at more than $1,000 a month. Even so, it's not nearly the solution that its proponents make it out to be, according to Michael Weinstein, president of the AIDS Healthcare Foundation, one of the largest AIDS organizations in the world.
The evidence shows that it is not a good public health strategy.
Why is that?
Well, because people don't adhere.
While studies have shown that the regimen can be over 90% effective when taken every day, Weinstein points out that the efficacy drops off when people miss their daily dose. He also says that relying on a pill instead of a condom may lead to a rise in other sexually transmitted diseases.
The motivation that people have for taking Truvada is to be able to have sex without a condom.
Do you think that people don't want to wear condoms either?
I think men in general don't want to wear condoms. That's just an absolute truth. I mean, and it's not surprising. But, you know, we don't want to wear seatbelts either, you know, or helmets or a lot of other things, but they're a necessity.
So wouldn't it be better then to just take a pill every day instead of worrying about transmitting HIV?
You know what? If it was guaranteed that everybody would take it every day as prescribed, obviously our attitude about it would be completely different if we didn't have to rely on the person to take that pill every single day.
While Kaiser Permanente's recent study of Truvada users found that none contracted HIV, it also showed that 41% of participants reported a decrease in condom use. And after 1 year of Truvada use, 50% were diagnosed with another STD. San Francisco Department of Public Health Chief Barbara Garcia says the city is working to make sure the drug is taken as prescribed and that it doesn't lead to other safe sex practices being abandoned.
We have already started in trying to educate young people particularly about this, and that's one of the challenges of having, even if we had a cure, that would be the same challenge we would have.
Do you see that happening though? I mean, obviously if you're having unsafe sex, you're going to be transmitting other sexually transmitted diseases.
And in fact, we've seen a little bit of a rise in STD here in San Francisco, and we're also addressing that as well.
It's not clear that an increase in STDs is related to an increase in the use of Truvada, and Garcia is committed to the drug regimen being a part of getting to zero in San Francisco, and believes that the city's approach to ending HIV, including the lives and money it will save, will eventually trump any controversy.
You can prove to them that you can save money by your model.
Absolutely. An HIV prevention versus an HIV positive client in care? Yes, we can.
San Francisco has made tremendous advances in battling an epidemic that hit the city harder than most. And according to Dr. Diane Havlier, actually getting to zero is within reach.
I think we would all acknowledge that it is going to be difficult to do, but I think if, as we say, if anybody can do it, we think that we can show people how it can be done starting here.
San Francisco's Mayor Ed Lee announced last month that he is allocating $1.2 million a year for getting to zero. The funding will increase rapid testing programs, expand the use of Truvada, and enlarge the number of HIV-positive patients who receive care.